Please read this disclaimer. This video's all the character and all of its contents, including any disease and opinions expressed by the narrator, are strictly for entertainment purposes only. And it is not intended in any way as a substitute for professional service and consultation from licensed therapist, doctor, attorney, or other licensed professional service provider. Each person must make their own life decision, and those decisions are theirs. Hey listeners, welcome back to another out-of-world news story with Revolving Time. Time is a fascinating and universal concept that affects every aspect of our lives and uncover the hidden secrets and truths. Today's story is new territory for me. I tell you now that there is no cheating and revenge in it, so if you are looking for one of our usual stories, sorry, this is one that has been in my mind for some time. It has a true basis, garnered from a certain person from where I work. Only the names have been changed, to protect the innocent. It is a romantic love story that has much truth behind it. In some ways, I hope that someone will get something from this that helps them in their lives. Okay, let's go to the story and see what happened in their love. I am Dave and my girlfriend Kelly. It all started when I overheard Kelly talking to one of her close friends on the phone. I had been dating Kelly for about 2 years and we were getting to the point where I was beginning to want to ask her to marry me. Kelly is the type of woman that many would overlook in a crowd. However, once you get to know her, you realize that she is a very beautiful and loving person. She hides her body with oversized clothes, not liking attention that her close to perfect shape brings. We met at a party one New Year's night at a mutual friend's place. We found a lot in common, and even though I wasn't really that interested in her at that time, I found myself asking her out a week later. After a few months of dating, we got to the point where one night she ended up at my place. I made her a nice dinner, and afterwards, as we watched a movie on my couch, we started to kiss. Before I knew what was happening, we were in my bed and I discovered that Kelly was a sexual dynamo. Without going into details, she showed me a side of her I never even imagined existed. Her attitude in bed was all out and anything goes. I was overwhelmed and trying to catch up for the whole night. After that night, we became closer than ever. It wasn't an all's rosy relationship by any means. I, being a natural man, forgot or didn't do some things that would cause her to be hurt or mad. She, of course, being the woman's woman, would do things to drive me nuts. We were not living together, her parents being a very strong influence on her life. She felt that even though we were having sex, for her to move in with me would cause trouble with her parents. Out of love for her and respect for her parents, I never pressed harder for her to move in with me. Anyway, this day she was talking to her girlfriend and I heard things that scared me and also made me feel bad. I guess that when it came to days like anniversaries or special days like Valentine's Day, I was a poor excuse of a person. I always forgot them and even sometimes didn't remember until days afterwards. Kelly had spent the afternoon at my place where we had just finished up some out-of-this-world sex. I had taken a shower after Kelly, who evidently called Gina as I was in the bathroom. What I overheard shocked me to my core as I thought that our relationship was going great. Oh Gina, if Dave forgets Valentine's Day this year, I don't know what I'll do. Sometimes I think he just dates me and says the things he does so he can have a steady piece of ass. He never remembers the important things about me or dates. I was a bit hurt. I actually loved Kelly with all my heart and here she was telling Gina that I was just keeping her around for a steady piece. I was crushed. I know that somehow this was my fault, that my poor memory was the cause of all her feelings like she was talking about. Kelly went on. Yeah, I know Gina, but what's the point of having a hot guy for a boyfriend when he doesn't care enough to remember the small things too? I swear if Dave forgets this Valentine's Day, I'm leaving him. There was a pause as Gina was evidently telling her something of vast importance. If I had known that Gina was rooting for me instead of running me down all that time, I could have gone to her and found out what to do. I knew that was not likely what Gina was doing though. Gina and I had never seen exactly eye to eye. She had felt that Kelly was far too good for the likes of me and I felt like she was always attacking me in front of Kelly. The whole 2 years I had known her, she had never said more than two good things about me at all that I knew of. I was sitting there thinking that Gina was trying to talk Kelly into leaving me. I was getting mad. And since I couldn't very well be mad at myself for being such an about dates and stuff, I decided to blame it all on Gina. Kelly was going on. Oh Gina, you know it's not just this Valentine's Day. Dave forgets everything. I'm constantly having to remind him of anniversaries and things. If only he would just remember one damn date and surprise me, I probably wouldn't feel so bad. I think he really doesn't care that much about me. I'm just a piece of meat for him to get off with, then he forgets all about me. A long pause as Gina was surely telling her how right she was and how much stupid I was. I knew that Gina couldn't possibly be telling Kelly anything good about me considering our past. I was beginning to try to think of how I was going to surprise Kelly and try to remember more things for her. Kelly was talking again, and from what I could overhear, Gina had been raking me over the coals. Oh, Gina, I don't think so. Even he wouldn't do that. I know that Dave is always telling me he loves me. I think that. Well, no dot dot dot, but I do love him, you know. Gina, you're impossible. What makes you think that will prove anything? I don't know. Gina, that sounds so devious. Look, Dave's going to be getting out of the shower pretty quick. I'll talk to you later, okay? I could see that Gina was trying to cook up something that involved me and Kelly. I was beginning to really not like her even more now. Who did she think she was trying to drive a wedge between Kelly and I anyway? I was getting mad. And that is probably what really got things rolling then and there. Update: later that day, after I dropped Kelly off at her place, I drove over to a buddy's house and talked with him about what I should do. Mike wasn't much help at all. I think he was waiting for a breakup between Kelly and I so he could move in on her. Then I remembered Sam. He had gotten married a few years ago. I hadn't talked to him too much, but I figured that he would have some answers for me and good advice on what I should do. I realized that I was fighting to keep Kelly now that I was ready to ask her to marry me. So close, in fact, I had been going to bring it up after my shower that fateful day. After overhearing the conversation though, well, you know why I didn't. Sam proved to be a true friend and gave me lots of advice. I wrote most of it down since I knew my memory wasn't the best, and after leaving his place I started right away on trying my best to keep Kelly. I made reservations at a pretty swank restaurant. It was one I knew Kelly had mentioned several times. Come to think of it, Gina had talked about it a few times too. At the time I figured that Gina had been rubbing in the fact that her boyfriend had taken her there, like I couldn't afford to take Kelly there or something along those lines. After making the reservations and paying the advance fee to guarantee them, I then went shopping for a special gift for Kelly. I found her a nice brooch, and then, since I was in a jewelry store, I began to look at wedding rings. On impulse, I picked out a beautiful engagement ring with a nice diamond setting. It cost a bundle, and I had to go to the bank to move some money around from my savings to checking in order to get it right at that moment. Then I went out and bought myself a new suit. I went to a store that had a guy that helped me to dress up. I knew that I wasn't going to be able to pick out the right stuff at all. This guy set me up pretty well, and at one point, as I stepped out of the dressing room, I heard a couple of women making comments about me. I was embarrassed and blushed, and they laughed a bit, teasing me just a little as they walked away. Their comments had been good and I should have been happy, but it also made me realize that it was very easy to treat anyone like a piece of meat. After getting my new suit, I went to the hairdresser and got a new style. That was a hard thing for me to do since I had always liked my rough and easy low-care self. What I was doing now was the metrosexual thing, and I wasn't sure if it was a good move or not. Sam had insisted that it was necessary though. That night Kelly made a comment about my hair. I could tell she liked it quite a bit. Oh wow, Dave, your hair looks great. What brought that change on anyway? Oh, just thought that you would like it. I was tired of that old cut anyway. Tired of the old cut, huh? Yeah, why? What's the big deal anyway? I was nervous and under a bit of pressure. Kelly usually didn't have all the questions for me like tonight, and it had me off guard. I was sure that her and Gina had too much time together today, and I could also feel something in the air. I'd like to take you out Friday. Special dinner, and all, for Valentine's Day. You know, why was I so nervous? I usually never stuttered or was shy around Kelly anymore. My tongue was all tied up and my heart beating like it was the first time I had ever asked anyone out on a date. Valentine's Day. You're asking me out on Valentine's Day. Do you feel all right, Dave? Yes. What's so unusual about my taking you out anyway? Well, it's the first time you've ever asked me out on this particular day to begin with. Yeah, well, geez, Kelly, you know I love you. I just wanted to show you that. I did have some plans dot dot dot, but I guess I can cancel them. Plans? What kind of plans did you have for Valentine's Day anyway? Oh, nothing much really. I was going out with Gina to a party. But, since you asked me out, I'll go with you of course. Gina, a party. Is there something you want to tell me, Kelly? What's happening between us? Dave, what's gotten into you? You know that Gina and I go way back. I just figured that you weren't going to ask me out on Friday, so I made some plans with Gina. Lighten up. I could see that Kelly was just a touch mad with me. I guess I did sound a bit jealous. I was. I was also scared that I was losing the one person I loved most in life. Kelly went home pretty early that night. I was sure that Kelly was getting ready to cut me loose. She had never gone without sex for more than a couple of days, and those being that time of the month. I knew it wasn't that time, and then, as I thought about it, I realized that Kelly and I had only spent a few hours together this whole week. Update 1. Then, on Friday morning, disaster struck. First off, I got a call at work. It was the restaurant. They were canceling my reservations. It seemed that some ultra-rich bigwig had reserved the whole damn place and insisted that all other reservations be canceled. I argued intensely, but to no avail. The maitre was quite insistent that my reservation was canceled and my money would be refunded. I frantically tried to find other reservations, but everyone was booked up solid. In desperation, I decided a nice romantic dinner at home would be okay. Then came the second phone call with bad news. My apartment building had caught on fire. The place below mine had burned, and to make a long story short, all my clothes and personal items had been soaked and ruined. I even had to find another place to live now. I sat back in my chair at my desk and went blank. In the matter of a few minutes, my whole life had been shot to hell. No possible way to save this day now. I had only a few hours until it was time to get ready to pick up Kelly. Then I remembered the ring. It had been in my apartment on my dresser. I left work and went home, or rather, to what was left of it. My place was a large dark black hole. Not only were my clothes and stuff ruined ... they had been burned to a crisp. Where my dresser had sat was a hole that went clear to the basement. I sat on the curb, head in my hands, wondering what could possibly go wrong now. Never wonder ... it can always get worse. I looked up to see Kelly in my supposed good friend's Jeep riding by. She turned as if to hide from me when she saw me sitting on the curb. I had lost her. My good buddy had helped himself quite nicely, it seemed. I was allowed to look through the rubble later that day and actually found the ring still in the box. What good it was going to do me now, I didn't know. I went to my parents' house in the burbs and showered and cleaned up. I still had some clothes at home, a bit old but they still fit. I sat around the house for a bit until my dad and mom finally drove me nuts with all their talking, so I went out and into the city. I found myself at Sam's place. He took one look at me and let me in. Him and his wife were both all over me, making sure I was okay. I took Sam aside and told him of my whole day. He couldn't believe that my day had gone so wrong so fast. We ate, and during dinner the phone rang. Sam turned to me and offered me the phone. "It's Gina. She says it's important." When I answered the phone, it all came out. The anger, the frustration, the hurt. I really dumped on her without warning. Called to gloat, bish. Happy now. Kelly's with that wonderful as hall I thought was a friend. My place is gone. Wouldn't surprise me to find out you set it on fire anyway. Well ... go ahead. Gloat. You're getting your way now. Dave ... what in the hell is the matter with you? I am surely not gloating. Kelly still loves you. And no matter what you may think, I care for you too. We just heard your place burned, and I've been trying to get a hold of you all afternoon. You just heard, huh? I saw Kelly in that ... as drive by. I saw Kelly trying to hide when she saw me sitting on the curb. I saw them together, running around cheating on me on probably the worst day of my life. I slammed the phone down, my anger taking away all reason. I thanked Sam and his wife for the dinner and left. They were trying to stop me from going. I think that Sam knew I was going to go get real drunk. I went to a place that I used to go to before Kelly. BK. I laughed to myself. I had initials now to set a date and time that I probably would never forget. I sat there drinking one after the other. The bartender was reluctant to serve me, but I managed to get him to give me a few more drinks way past what he should have. I was on my lips drunk when in walked Kelly and Gina. Kelly had red-rimmed eyes from crying, and Gina looked pissed. I didn't care anymore. I just sat there drinking my last drink, the bartender avoiding my end of the bar now. Kelly came up to me trying to hug me. I shoved her away, angry that she would try that. Dave, what's wrong with you? If it's about Mike and I and his Jeep today. I'm sorry. What? Sorry that I caught you running around with that as hall. Dave, you're drunk and not thinking straight. Come to my place and we'll talk. We will talk here or not at all. I still loved her so much I couldn't even call her a name like Bish. I was drunk and angry and still couldn't call her a Bish. I was sure she had cheated on me, leaving me for a friend I had. Dave, there has been a huge misunderstanding. I still love you, Dave. Please, come home with me. Gina stepped in close to me for the first time. If you weren't so drunk and pathetic right now, I'd kick you. Kelly loves you and here you sit trying to drive her away. Get over yourself, Dave. You need to sleep it off and then talk in the morning. Oh, and you have been such an angel to me the past 2 years. Always something negative about me in some form or another. You have wanted me to break up with Kelly from day one. I slammed down the last of my drink and grabbed my last glass still sitting on the bar. As I drank that one, I began to feel dizzy and numb. I had way too much to drink and my mind was getting foggy. At some point I passed out. The bartender helped the girls to carry me to Kelly's car. Update 2, I woke up in the morning. I got up and found that I had one hell of a huge headache. I made it to the bathroom. After a bit I was able to get up and walk about. I found my clothes washed and folded laying on a chair in the corner of the room. Evidently, Kelly had put them there while I was in the bathroom. I got dressed and noticed that my pockets were empty. I went out into the kitchen to get a drink and found Gina and Kelly both sitting there waiting. "Hey, feel kinda poorly, do we?" Gina was being her usual smartest self, it seemed. I was surprised since I had figured she would have been dancing a victory dance over me, having got her way. Kelly just sat there staring at the table. "Well, I hope you're happy now. Kelly didn't sleep a wink last night." "No, I'm not happy. Do you have any idea how much trouble you caused us last night? Man, your place burning down sucked. But when you took off and then got drunk in that bar, that was too much. Sam told me you were real upset. He couldn't get you to stay though. By the time Kelly and I got there, you had fled the scene and gone to that dumpster site called a bar."
"What? What do you mean Sam told you? When did you talk to Sam? How do you even know Sam anyway?"
"Well, Special Dave Kelly called your parents' place, then tracked you down to Sam's. He told us where you'd probably go. We went to the first three places and you weren't there. Then, at that last place, there you were. I have never seen you so drunk the whole time I've known you."
"Yeah, well, not to worry. You won't ever see me that way again."
"What, you want to get me here so you could rub it all in my face?" I was mad. I didn't understand why they had drugged me to Kelly's place in the first place. I figured that my parents had asked Kelly to keep an eye on me just in case. I looked for the first time at Kelly and saw her shoulders shaking. She was crying. Feeling real low, I slumped into a chair and just sat there, looking at the one person I truly loved and didn't know what to do. Gina glared at me, then went to the desk in the corner. She brought out the stuff that had been in my pockets. The receipt for the dinner reservations, the receipt for my new clothes, and the smoked and slightly burned box that contained the ring. "These were in your pockets. I cleaned them out before I washed your clothes. Why don't you explain those three things to Kelly? I know I'd like to hear your story." Gina had pointed out the two receipts and the box. I looked at them and then felt the heat of a blush covering my head. Kelly had stopped crying and was just looking at me. I had to know something first, before I made a fool of myself.
"Why, Kelly, why were you riding around with him? Why did you try to hide your face when I saw you?
You won't understand, Dave. Try me. After my day yesterday, I think the least you can do is let me know what's going on. Mike came and got me. He heard that your place had burned and he got me so I could go see if there was anything to save. When I saw you sitting there, and that look in your eyes, I knew that you thought the worst. I didn't know what else to do, but obviously what I did was the wrong thing. So you're telling me that Mike just came to bring you over to my place?
That's all."
"Yes, Jesus, Dave, quit being such an ass. She loves you way more than you deserve. I don't understand it myself, but the least you could do is go easy on her. Things haven't been exactly easy for her either." Gina exploded at me, and I realized for the first time that she was right. I had misread this whole last day or so. Her outburst focused my attention on the present and how lucky I really was that Kelly still seemed to care for me.
"Well, what about your devious plan that you and Kelly talked about the other day?
You were trying to get her to dump me, that was obvious, you know. You listened to Kelly's phone call. I overheard it because I stepped out of the shower before you had finished talking. What do I have to do to prove to you that I love Kelly?
I have from almost day one. What do you have against me anyway?
Kelly has been my friend for a lot longer than you have been around Dave. And for your information, I have been trying to keep you two together. Kelly was trying to talk herself into dumping you and dating Mike. He is always quick to remember dates and details that you don't."
"What?"
"Look, Kelly loves you, but lately she has felt that you just don't care for her as much as she cares for you. She was thinking that you were about to dump her. I didn't see that her way and told her so. If you weren't such a screw up on dates and stuff, you two would have been so much happier by now. Damn, it's been hard for me to stick up for you, especially when you act like an idiot like yesterday. If I hadn't felt like an idiot before, I surely did now." Gina had been in my corner all this time. I realized that I had let my bad day yesterday go to my head and assume the worst in everything. I sat there feeling like a true fool.
This is the receipt for dinner at Del Rio's. They called me yesterday morning to tell me that the whole place had been reserved by some rich jerk and they were not honoring my reservations.
Del Rio's. Yeah, I wanted to take you there for dinner last night. I had something important I needed to ask you and I wanted it to be a special night for you.
Del Rio's. Yeah, what's the big deal?
Just a restaurant. That's the nicest place in town.
Oh, Dave, you remembered it was Valentine's Day and got reservations and everything.
Yeah, well, for all the good it did me, they canceled out on me,
on us.
But you remembered, Dave.
That's all that matters to me.
This is from where I got a new suit. Went through quite a bit to get it. Had some help. That guy that works at the Emporium set me up.
Isn't he the guy that does the metrosexual look?
You went to them.
Oh my God.
Gina had a look of shock as she blurted that out. I could see that she had never dreamed that I would go there for clothes ever.
I will admit that I have always been a blue jean and t-shirt kind of guy. Kelly was looking at me with a funny look. I could see that she was wondering what I had been thinking. Gina and Kelly were both shocked, and I was kind of liking the effect it had on them. If only it had been under far better circumstances. Final update. Then, as I remembered that ring in my hand in that burned box, I had an inspiration. I knelt on one knee in front of Kelly. Taking her hands in mine, I began the toughest question I had ever asked anyone before. Kelly gave me a confused look, and then she looked over at Gina. Gina had both her hands covering her mouth. She knew what Kelly was evidently missing. Gina had figured out when she cleaned out my pockets what the ring was and what I had intended to do last night. Kelly, I know that yesterday and today I have not been acted terribly. I know that I'm not the best catch in the ocean, nor am I good at remembering dates and stuff. I do know one thing though. Kelly, I love you. I love you fully and completely, with all my heart. I took the box and placed it in Kelly's hands, folding her fingers over it and holding her. Looking into her eyes, I finished what I had to ask. Kelly, I know that this isn't Del Rio's and that things haven't been real great in the last day or so. I am also painfully aware that I thought that you had left me for Mike and I should have known better. Would you marry me? Would you consider being my wife? Gina gasped as I finished my question. Kelly had tears running down her face and just looked at me with a look I had never seen before. The silence in the intervening time was deafening. I looked around at Gina, then back at Kelly. I was not sure what to think at that moment. Kelly leaned towards me and then opened the box. The ring inside still glittered and shined almost as beautiful as the woman holding it. Her hands shook as she took it out and pushed it onto the fourth finger of her left hand. I fit exactly right. I was surprised, since the jeweler had told me that it would definitely need to be resized to fit her. Then Kelly reached out and took me in her arms, hugging me close to her. Yes, I will marry you, Dave. Though, I felt her hot tears on my cheek as she held me close, and I could see Gina crying now too. I hugged Kelly tightly, and then we kissed. Her eyes were open and she kept looking at me, searching for something that I couldn't define. The next thing I knew, Gina had torn Kelly from my grasp and was hugging her hard. Tears flowed freely as they both cried and stared at the ring. I got up and then found my seat again. I watched as they danced around and kept exclaiming about everything. As I sat there, I heard the phone ring. The answering machine picked up. Kelly, it's me, Mike. Look, I need to tell you something. Dave isn't the guy for you. Not after yesterday anyway. Look, let me take you out for dinner, and we can talk. Before either Kelly or I could do anything, Gina grabbed up the phone. Hey Mike, you still on? Gina had a look that didn't bode well as she listened to Mike. Yeah, great. Listen up. Kelly isn't interested in you or any other man. She's got a keeper and you can duck off. Gina slammed the phone down and then started laughing. Kelly joined in, and pretty soon so was I. I had been stunned at her outburst at Mike. I could see all of a sudden that Gina actually liked me. Well, at least tolerated me now. That night, together, in Kelly's bed, she placed her head on my chest. She was looking at the engagement ring in the soft light. It still shined brightly even in the dim light. I could just make out a tear in her eye. What's wrong, Kelly? Nothing. Everything is so right. Everything is perfect. I love you, Dave. My reaction. The truth behind their love story was not just in its passion and authenticity, but in its willingness to confront the complexities of emotions. And so, Dave and Kelly's love story became a testament to the power of connection, weakness, and embracing the journey of life hand in hand. Their happy ending wasn't just a destination, it was a reflection of the beautiful, messy, and incredibly real love they had built together. Thank you for joining us on Revolving Time, where we bring you real life stories that explore the complexities of the human experience. We hope that our stories have provided you with insights, inspiration, and a renewed appreciation for the power of human resilience. We encourage you to subscribe to our channel and stay connected with our community. By subscribing, you will be the first to know about new stories and events, and you'll have access to a library of inspiring content. Thank you for being a part of our journey, and we look forward to sharing more powerful stories with you in the future.